You're indeed still listening too, despite all the warnings that your mom gave you or anybody else. WPRB in Princeton.
I want to talk a bit about some of the influences. I may be like way off in outer space on it. But.
Pretty all over the place. I mean, we can get compared to, I think, the krautrock thing sometimes, occasionally a math rock or something like that. But, you know, we're just kind of, we have a ton of influences, and we just, everybody brings that to the table. You know, everything from classic rock to, I don't know, what else would you consider?
Oh, God, jazz, classic rock.
Electronic stuff.
Yeah, a lot of electronic stuff.
The krautrock stuff's in there, though. I kind of came to that by way of David Bowie, though, finding out about, that Brian Eno produced this stuff and kind of went and found out about all that stuff.
The Berlin sessions.
Yeah, and from Eno on to, like, Cluster and things like that.
No, that just sounds very interesting to hear some of those sounds in there. But again, it's an entirely different sound because it's you guys. You say you bring in different influences. You guys always play together, or do you come from different projects?
A little bit of both. Me and James are cousins. We've grown up playing guitar together since we were 14, 15 years old.
Yeah.
And then in different bands off and on for years. And then met up with Ralph a year and a half, 2 years ago. Drums, and then Brian over here just joined the band about two days ago.
Almost.
About two months ago.
Yeah.
And he was in this fabulous band called Salas Fear, and they broke up, so we snatched up Brian.
Good snag. Good catch. So there are four of you, and three of you are drummers. Unless you were hiding something that I didn't see.
I'm actually a drummer, too.
Okay, four drummers. I noticed you guys have a lot of electronic drum stuff, and each of you sort of takes turns jumping in and out of the drum textures. Mm-hmm. Is that structured, or is that something that you just feel that moment and go?
A little of both, I guess, right? Yeah, I would say some of the songs that we've done, we found that we grab, like, one of the instruments I do is it's tape loops of drum samples and percussive tracks and shakers and stuff like that, so that's where I come from, and just kind of playing off them, but not trying to keep the rhythm of that, and just trying to take that to a new direction. And Steve kind of has the electronic drum kit in front of him, so he plays on top of that. So just through a simple delay pedal, just let it go.
We try not to be on top of each other too much with it. You know, it's too much freedom, so we're not like just.
But it works pretty well. Yeah, you've got the kit, Rob. You've got the traditional set there.
Yeah.
You're definitely doing a steady thing, but I notice you go off too into different percussive areas.
You know, a lot of different blocks and bells. Yeah, we have blocks and bells and shakers and all the little toys. I work in a drum store, so I have access to a lot of that. I can just pick a new toy a week and bring it in and try it out and that kind of stuff.
Well, was there any special toy tonight that you were particularly happy with?
A new little 25-cent whistle I got from a pinata at a birthday party. Sounds like a train. It's great.
Yeah. Well, is it plastic or metal or wood?
It's plastic. It's the cheapest you could possibly find. It's got a great sound to it.
Little train whistle. My favorite toy is just a potato head, but.
Yeah. Well,
damn.
So is it fair to say that anything you guys find percussively is sort of fair game to find something you're walking down the street and say, well, what's that? That's fair game to bring into the band?
Yeah, so. Percussively and non-percussively, whatever.
Might find that, like James and Steve find a lot of different sounds they like and just record it and use them with loops and things like that. Like, could be anything. If a door opening sounds good, you have to put a microphone to it and get something like.
There's one song on our CD where basically I just put one mic in the middle of like 8 or 9 music boxes and have them all going at once, and just recorded that, and then we record all sorts of weird noise underneath it. So whatever's around the house is fair game.
Yeah. Well, that's appreciated here. That's one of the bedrocks of this program. Is anything that makes noise is fair game, whether it's spoken word, music, sound effects, silence. And again, that's appreciated. A lot of phone callers, people saying, you know, what's going on? Where can I buy this? It's like, sorry if you're not recording it now. SOL. That's it.
Impact in the children.
recorded? You guys record at like a home studio?
James's bedroom, yeah.
Yeah, we put it at home studio. Kind of set up, you know, the digital setup, of a computer at home. And just, you know, pretty basic setup.
Did you guys record simultaneously, or did you have like multi-tracking and then go back? And
yeah, we did the overdub thing. We started with like guitars, and then actually it was kind of a backwards way. I think we started back with
really
guitars,
backwards.
And then we, you know, I think the last thing to record was drums on top of all the chaos.
That's interesting.
Yeah, it turned out pretty good.
The way the songs were written, they were most of the songs in the CD were written by me and James before when it was just me and James in the band. So we would go play shows, which it would just be me and James and a drum machine and loops, but no live percussion, no bass. And we just kind of got piece by piece and added it. So the stuff that we've, the stuff that's on our CD is coming from that, but the stuff that we're working on now and writing now is a lot more reliant on Ralph and Brian. So it's pretty different. That's
you're playing.
That's generally how we do it in practice too.
Yeah.
A couple of lights, enough to see. It's That's about it.
Yeah, but you certainly set the tone. I mean, you guys are painting the darkness yourself with the sound, and that just works so well to see you guys, or almost see you guys out there, because it's damn dark. it fills that room with a special kind of sound that I don't think you get when you've got the bright light. It's a different mindset.
Dr. Cosmo thought it sounded great.
I tried to start doing that, doing my part to that noise piece, that Painting Broken Circles song from the CD. I don't remember how I did it.
Did I start blue a little premature, or I didn't know what we were doing, and
I thought it was cool. What are we doing?
I was just trying to fill up some space there, so I had the tape ready. I think it was a great transition.
Yeah,
I thought the transitions in between were.
I thought they were really good.
I think we should do after Dreaming. I think we should do the Serenity noise thing.
Okay.
The Ebo, which is like real quiet, which we haven't done that in a while, but it's just basically like the big like drawn out Ebo thing that we've done before. It's in the same key as Blue, and we've opened Blue with it.
Let's go back and do that.